Protected.
A perfect storm in the NHS, with services in some areas close to collapse. The Health Secretary is blaming a toxic combination of COVID, flu and strep A. Critics, though, warn the situation is unsustainable and they claim the malaise lies much deeper.
More than a decade of underinvestment in the NHS has finally come home to roost.
Well, now the country's largest ambulance provider is warning it'll have to leave patients on trolleys in A&E after just 45 minutes, as it's too busy to look after them. Also tonight, no New Year resolution in the rail disputes as five consecutive days of strike action keep commuters at home again. The cost of living is taking its toll on domestic violence charities, with refugees warning of cuts or even closures and devastating consequences.
Women and children will die and be at risk of harm unless we get this right.
Brazil bids its final farewell to Pelé, a hometown show of love for the man who redefined football to become a worldwide star. And summery scenes in the south of France, if you can ignore the Christmas trees, that is. Unprecedented and unseasonal heat hits Europe.
This is the ITV Evening News with Mary Nightingale.
Good evening. The NHS is under unsustainable pressure and patients are dying unnecessarily because of the government's political choices. That is the accusation from the British Medical Association, which says the winter crisis is dire for both patients and staff, and is showing no sign of relenting. The Health Secretary insists there is funding in place to address the issues, but Labour said it was down to the Conservatives' mismanagement. More than a dozen NHS trusts and ambulance services declared critical incidents over the weekend. And ITV News has learned that the London Ambulance Service will only wait 45 minutes before leaving non-critical patients on trolleys at hospitals. We'll have more on that in just a moment. But first, here's our political correspondent, Libby Wiener, on the NHS emergency.
So this is what it's like at Torbay Hospital. I can't even believe how long I've been stuck here. From 8:30 this morning, it's now 5:30, and my mum is still stuck in an ambulance. There are so many ambulances just waiting.
Her mum, Irene, is 84 and has a serious lung condition. Her daughter made this video diary of their ordeal.
She's on her third drip now. They've only just given her some paracetamol pain relief. This is our NHS.
Last month, a quarter of ambulance patients waited more than an hour to be transferred to A&E. Once inside, a third waited more than 4 hours to be seen, and almost 38,000 waited more than 12 hours to get treated, a 355% increase on last year. Over the weekend, more than a dozen critical incidents were declared at hospital trusts around the country, including Stoke-on-Trent, where they say the pressure is unprecedented.
I've been in the NHS now for 38 years, and of those I've probably worked 32 Christmases, and I have to say that this has been the most difficult Christmas that I've ever witnessed.
For the government, the political pressure is also building. The Health Secretary first blamed the fact that too many people who could be discharged are stuck in hospital, then also the pandemic.
What we're particularly focused on is the challenge of patients who are fit to leave hospital, who are often delayed in doing so. That's why we've got record funding going into social care, an extra £500 million this year, and a much bigger package in terms of the next 2 years.
You've had 12 years to get this right, this issue of social care. You're saying you're putting the money in now, but it's all too late for these people sitting in ambulances outside hospitals, isn't it?
Well, what we're seeing in terms of both the pressure on cardiovascular deaths, and also the pressure on operations backlogs, is a massive surge of demand as a consequence of the pandemic.
But NHS managers say the problems are more deep-rooted.
I think it's been an accumulation over more than a decade of underinvestment in the NHS has finally come home to roost. I think that we've seen signs that that's been happening over the past couple of years, but of course, COVID has proved quite a distraction from really recognising the scale of those challenges.
Number 10 are playing down talk of a crisis, but most people working in the NHS feel that's exactly what it is. Libby Vina, ITV News, Westminster.
Well, the winter crisis is so acute, ambulances in London are only going to be waiting 45 minutes before leaving patients on trolleys at hospital. That decision was revealed in a leaked email seen by ITV News, and our UK editor Paul Brand is outside St Thomas's Hospital in central London tonight. Paul, what is behind this then?
Well, Mary, essentially ambulance crews are having to make an impossible decision. Do they attend to new 999 calls or do they continue attending to the patient that's right there in front of them? We know, as we've heard in Libby's report, that people are having to wait for hours outside hospital on the back of ambulances because there's no space in A&E. The ambulance staff can't offload them, can't hand them over to the hospital. Now a time cap is going to be placed on how long ambulances are willing to wait in London. This email leaked to us tonight at ITV News, sent to senior staff across the NHS in London, states quite clearly, from today, January the 3rd, we are asking that any patients waiting for 45 minutes for handover are handed over immediately to emergency department staff, allowing the ambulance clinicians to leave and respond to the next patient waiting in the community. What that means is if the patient is stable, they will essentially be left on a trolley or a chair in a corridor waiting to get into A&E. Again, we've seen scenes across the country, people waiting for days in that kind of situation because there's no space in the A&E. The NHS in London says they're dealing with record demand. This is the way that they're trying to deal with that demand. Senior doctors tonight, though, say this is simply freeing up ambulances only to clog up hospital corridors.
OK, Paul Brand outside St Thomas's Hospital in central London. Thank you. OK, well, that's the situation in London. Well, let's the issues with the health service have affected areas up and down the UK. Our Wales reporter Rhys Williams is outside the Princess of Wales Hospital in Bridgend. So, Rhys, are there similar issues there to start this new year?
Yes, there are. Unfortunately, the NHS here doesn't seem to be coping at all. In the north of the country, Wales's largest health board has declared a critical incident. That means no, of course, routine appointments or procedures, and the situation's not much better here in the south, in Swansea and in Cwmtaf Morgannwg health board area. They've asked people not to go to A&E unless absolutely necessary. You can see the row of ambulances there behind me, an indication of the pressures that nurses and doctors are under in emergency care. And we hear the language there being used to describe the NHS in England, perfect storm, danger, of course. Similar language is being used here. One senior health boss described the NHS as being on a knife edge here in Wales earlier today. And the Welsh Government, which is, of course, responsible for the health service, says that this situation is totally unprecedented.
OK, Rhys Williams in Bridgend. Thank you. Well, as the NHS crisis continues, the parents of a toddler who died from suspected sepsis have told ITV News they feel her life should have been saved by medics. Hayley Thompson was sent home after being seen at accident and emergency at Wigan Infirmary, but she was found unresponsive the following morning. Her devastated parents told our North of England reporter Rachel Townsend that tests should have been carried out.
Just 3 weeks ago, Hayley Thompson was giddy with excitement about the days ahead. But the toddler didn't live to see Christmas.
I still keep thinking what we could have done differently. But everyone's saying we are not medical professionals, we couldn't do more than take her to the GP, take her to the hospital.
The 22-month-old had cold-like symptoms for most of December. Her parents had been reassured it was a virus, but when Hayley's breathing changed, they called 999. After being told an ambulance was at least an hour away, Hayley's father drove her here to Wigan A&E himself.
They waited over 4.5 hours to see a doctor who checked the toddler's temperature and blood pressure before sending her home. The following morning, Chris found his daughter unresponsive in her cot. She was rushed back here in an ambulance with her mother, but died before Chris arrived.
Hayley was in fact suffering from sepsis and pneumonia.
Just test her, just do something. Not say, oh yeah, she's just got a viral infection, come back in 2 or 3 days, because obviously 2 or 3 days is too late.
Today, the NHS Trust responsible told us our sincere condolences are with Hayley's family, adding the Trust is currently carrying out an investigation, taking into account the concerns raised by them. The day after Hayley's death, the Trust declared a critical incident due to immense pressure on services.
I loved every single thing about her, how clever she was, how funny she was, how she just used to shout me, mommy, mommy. I just don't understand how can someone die of this here.
And what makes their grief even more unbearable is their belief that their daughter's death was entirely avoidable. Rachel Townsend, ITV News, Wigan.
The government is also under pressure over the escalating series of public sector strikes. Today, a new round of walkouts started on the railways. Action by the RMT and ASLEF unions over the next few days is set to cripple almost all services until Saturday. It is the biggest such strike for decades, but the government and Network Rail say there is hope for a deal. Here's our consumer editor, Chris Choi, on a tough start to the new year for many.
Empty train lines and busy picket lines. As if today's big return to work wasn't gruelling enough. In Birmingham, a new year with the old rail problems.
It is causing a lot of disruption, especially at the start of the year when we're just trying to get back into our offices.
You can't afford to give everybody a pay rise, otherwise we'll be in a worse state.
I know why they're doing it. I think they're doing it for good reasons.
This week sees 2 48-hour strikes by members of RMT Union, meaning disruption into the weekend, with Network Rail saying Sunday services will also start later. And on Thursday, train drivers in the ASLEF Union take action at 15 train companies.
Today, only 20% of services have run. That's around 16 million fewer journeys. And the trains that do run this week are likely to be a lot busier than normal.
Well, the offer was put to our members.
The RMT leader got members a 9% pay offer in December, which today rail bosses say was not considered properly.
You only gave your members 7 days to consider all the complexity of that deal.
They fully understood what was going on and they rejected it. Two-thirds of them voted against the proposals.
Aren't you damaging your own members' prospects because the public are losing faith in this form of transport?
Well, the public is losing faith in the way the railway is structured and the way that the government is controlling the railway.
The RMT claims a deal could have been reached before Christmas if the government had not intervened.
Isn't the union absolutely right in saying you don't have a mandate to do a deal?
We have to comply with the public sector pay guidelines, and we do. And we demonstrated to government how the reforms that we're making save money and result in a more efficient railway.
There have been no formal dispute talks since mid-December, with none planned this week. Many businesses, like this hairdresser's, rely heavily on commuters. Today, they were left with fewer customers and no idea when the strikes will end.
Well, it means that more people are working at home, so therefore it's had an impact on us, where it's a lot more quieter.
Don't travel by rail if you can avoid it is the stark message. The one thing both sides agree on is just how bad this week will be for passengers. Chris Choi, ITV News.
Well, is there hope then for an end to these disputes? Our political correspondent Harry Horton is in Westminster. So, Harry, Chris mentioned it there. Government's hinting of some cause for optimism. Is that true?
Well, this morning, Mark Harper, the Transport Secretary, told me that there has been progress, in his view, in recent weeks. The boss of Network Rail has said that he thinks a deal is within touching distance. And this evening, the leader of the RMT, Mick Lynch, he says that he's optimistic about a deal, and he says there's been warm words with the rail companies in recent weeks. However, behind the scenes, government sources have told me tonight that they have seen evidence, they think, of more and more rail workers choosing to cross the picket line as the financial impact of these strikes begins to hit. Downing Street has said it might introduce tough new anti-strike legislation for the rail network in the coming weeks. The unions have already said that they would oppose that in the courts if that were to happen. There are more talks scheduled for next week between unions and the rail companies. We'll see then, I think, whether these warm words seemingly in public materialise into any sort of concrete progress when it comes to these talks.
OK, Harry Horton at Westminster, thank you. It wasn't just rail workers on strike today. Some national highways workers who are in the PCS union are striking today and tomorrow. That includes road traffic officers and control room operators. And driving examiners are also striking in Wales and parts of England until January the 10th. The government says this will only affect practical tests and not theory tests. So moving on now, and a British couple who died in a double helicopter crash in Australia have been named as Diane and Ron Hughes. They were from Liverpool and had only married last year. A pilot and another passenger also died in the accident, which happened near the SeaWorld Resort on the Gold Coast. John Ray has the latest.
In the skies above Australia's Gold Coast, horror, as two helicopters carrying tourists collide. The rotor blade of one slicing through the cockpit of another.
In the water!
Whose pilot fights for control and comes down somehow safely on a sandbank. The wreckage from the first aircraft, moments after it had taken off, is strewn along the rising water's edge, blades buried in the beach. On board, Diane Hughes and her husband Ron, not long married, they were on holiday together. Their family say they're heartbroken. Their pilot and another passenger were also killed. Three others, including two children, were badly injured.
This is very traumatic, and certainly our thoughts and condolences go out to the families of all those involved.
The collision took place close to a crowded holiday park.
One was trying to land and they just turned around and just smacked into each other. Yeah. One flew directly up into the other.
I heard the noise and both the kids went, oh my God, that helicopter just crashed.
What seemed strange today was that it was so windy and that helicopters were out, you know, and so close together.
Rescue teams were hampered by the tides, though all those on board the second helicopter survived, despite the damage to the cockpit.
That's been a remarkable achievement. So whilst it has been very tragic that four people have lost their lives and many families are mourning this morning, we could have had a far worse situation.
Australia's Prime Minister called it a terrible and tragic incident. An investigation is underway into how a holiday treat ended in disaster. John Ray, ITV News.
There is plenty more still to come in the ITV Evening News, including exclusive figures which show the vast majority of domestic abuse charities are struggling to afford to provide their vital services.
We've got children living here, we've got vulnerable adults living here. We can't cut off the gas and electricity supply.
The body of Pelé laid to rest after a procession which saw thousands line the streets in his hometown. Why snow is in short supply at ski resorts across Europe. All that and plenty more coming up after the break. Join me then.
Would a waistcoat pop?
The greatest storyteller always had the perfect story whenever you needed to hear it. There were adventures that could stir the weariest soul. Or even move you to tears. But surely, a storyteller so great must be just another story, right?
Save on everything. All these products are now at their lowest price ever. Only in the Oak Furnitureland winter sale. Ends Sunday.
Right now at B&Q, get 25% off kitchens when you spend £5,000 on a kitchen, or 15% off when you spend £3,000. With flexible finance options, it's easier than ever to make the heart of your home your own. Book an appointment at DIY.com today. You can do it.
Gum problems can cause more problems, like bad breath and sensitive teeth. Corsodil Gum Plus is scientifically proven to target gum problems to help protect your whole mouth. Corsodil Gum Plus, breath and sensitivity.
The thing with Dad is, he's always got a grand plan.
Probably no shots.
That's what I thought it'd look a bit tropical.
It always starts with food. The spicier the better. Then he'll get distracted by something shiny. But once he's got all the gear, there's no stopping him. Yep. That's my dad. Just a big kid, excited to meet a turtle. My cheeks hurt thinking about that day. And what a numpty he is. What a holiday that was.
14-night Caribbean holidays from $1,199 per person. Atoll protected.
Whether you're planning a renovation or searching for your perfect piece, Best Heating has you covered. Whatever your style, from modern designer radiators to traditional column and cast iron radiators, our wide selection in electric, hot water and dual fuel can make the functional beautiful. And with fast and free delivery, you're closer to cool than you might think. Warm up and chill out this winter. January sale now on. Visit bestheating.com. Heating made cooler.
I won't even roll the dice so that you can't play me twice, no babe. Who do you think I am? Well, I'm gonna take my own road. And I'm sorry, baby.
Enjoy huge savings of up to 70% off the RRP in the Boundary Outlet winter sale.
Did you know meat and dairy naturally contain vitamin B12, which can help your body release energy? Enjoy the goodness.
At Ryanair, we love flying you and your family. Wherever you'd like to go, our friendly crew are happy to care for you. Fly Ryanair and you'll love our low fares, on-time flights and sunshine destinations. Don't delay. Book your summer break today to get our low fares before they sell out. Ryanair. Low fares. Great care.
Hello again, welcome back. Thousands of Brazilians have lined the streets of Pelé's hometown, Santos, as his coffin arrived at its final resting place. Watched by adoring fans, the procession passed by the house of Pelé's 100-year-old mother before heading to a special cemetery where the star will be laid to rest. From Brazil, here's our sports editor Steve Scott on the final farewell to a footballing hero.
From quiet reflection to an explosion of noise to celebrate Pelé's life. The football club estimates nearly a quarter of a million have paid tribute in the past 24 hours. The last in the queue, Itacil Ferreira, before the doors closed for the final time. Already inside the stadium, Brazil's newly inaugurated president, Lula da Silva. Soon after he consoled Pelé's grieving family, Brazil's most loved son was carried from the stadium. As is tradition here, Pelé was then placed onto the roof of a fire truck, his coffin draped in the national flag, the yellow and green he wore with such distinction during his astonishing career. Santos fans, most who'd never seen him play, there to give their hero a spectacular send-off. Slowly the cortege made its way through Santos's narrow streets. In Brazil, Pelé is considered royalty, and today that was never more obvious.
It was always about playing football, and that's Pelé, you know?
A celebration of a great man.
Enchanted the world. This is our guy. This is what Brazil is about.
You think he'd be happy?
Yeah, of course. Today? Of course.
look at this party and how many people are here in the streets just for celebrating his life.
The procession, accompanied by a soundtrack of chanting, applause and cries of Viva Pelé, Pelé lives.
Every meter along this route is packed with tens of thousands of people all wanting to say goodbye to the great footballer and the great Brazilian. It's a journey they anticipated taking a couple of hours. It will probably take a lot longer than that.
Along the route, Pelé's mother's house. At 100 years old, she's too confused to understand her son has died. Pelé's sister thanked those who'd come to show the family their support. A day full of chaos and colour eventually came to a peaceful and solemn end. Pelé taken inside the vertical cemetery where his family were waiting. All Brazil hoping the emotion they witnessed today will help as they contemplate life without him. Steve Scott, ITV News, Santos.
And for continuing coverage of the reaction to Pelé's death and his funeral this evening, you can head to the news section of ITVX. Let's move on to other news now. And a man has appeared in court charged with the murder of a missing woman from southeast London. 24-year-old Maureen Guittard was reported as missing by her family on the 10th of December. She was last seen leaving her home in Deptford 5 days earlier. Mark Moody appeared at Bromley Magistrates Court today to confirm his personal details. Hampshire police have launched an investigation after the bodies of a 17-year-old girl and a 42-year-old woman were found at a property in the hamlet of Downton. The discovery made last Thursday is not being treated as suspicious. And a woman who falsely claimed she was victim of an Asian grooming gang has been convicted of perverting the course of justice. 22-year-old Eleanor Williams posted pictures of injuries and an account of being trafficked on Facebook in May 2020, which was then shared more than 100,000 times. An American football match was abandoned last night after a player collapsed on the field with a suspected cardiac arrest. Damar Hamlin, who plays for NFL side Buffalo Bills, was injured during the game in Cincinnati in Ohio. He remains in a critical condition in hospital. Our correspondent Robin Moore reports begins with the build-up to the incident.
Good protection, end zone, touchdown, what a start!
It was a much-anticipated game between the Buffalo Bills and the Cincinnati Bengals. But it has put American football back at the heart of an anguished debate about the safety of players. This appeared to be a routine play when Damar Hamlin, wearing the number 3 shirt, collided with another player. He fell awkwardly, but got to his feet for a few seconds before then collapsing and falling backwards.
Not what any of us want to see, and everybody's around him, and just hope that he's going to be okay.
It quickly became clear this was a medical emergency. Paramedics and an ambulance responding quickly, with Hamlin in cardiac arrest on the field. Teammates formed a circle to pray for the player's survival and recovery. Many in tears. The game itself was first suspended and then cancelled. And Hamlin was taken to hospital where he remains in critical condition, with dozens of fans holding an overnight vigil outside.
Well, it's everybody coming together and, you know, it's a big family, and that's what it is. We're all here for him, and I'm just glad to see two different cities come together.
My grandson wanted to come down. We're avid sports fan, bingo fan, and he just said, can we go, you know, down and pray.
What's up? It's Damar Hamlin. Back at the hometown, back at the crib. Third annual toy drive, man. We're doing it for the kids.
Hamlin is a popular player from Pittsburgh who has spent time raising funds to buy toys for children impacted by the COVID pandemic. This is an incident that will raise further questions about American football, with its high risk in particular of concussions. But for now, the focus is on Damar Hamlin and his fight to pull through. Robert Moore, ITV News, Washington.
You're watching the ITV Evening News. Here's what's still ahead before Emmerdale. The world of motoring remembers the daring skill and bravery of rally driver Ken Block.
As with a lot of people, that would be truly terrifying, that sort of thing. But he was so good and so incredibly precise. Within a minute, you thought, there's absolutely nothing to worry about here.
Two men go on trial accused of a knife point robbery at the home of Olympic cycling champion Mark Cavendish. Temperature records are fried as parts of Europe experience an unprecedented January heatwave.
But fewer bathing suits and more brollies in tonight's national weather forecast, plus showers of a different sort. I'll explain all towards the end of the programme.
Good day for the shoeshine boy.
And why the days of seeing your reflection in your shoes may well be over. But before all that, ITV News has learned that domestic abuse services in England are under threat of cuts or even closure because of the cost of living crisis. Figures shared with us by the charity Women's Aid show that two-thirds of refugees say they will have to reduce support for survivors, either turning people away or, in some cases, even shutting their doors if they don't get financial help. One domestic abuse charity in Merseyside has told us they're in a desperate situation and are racking up massive debts because of rising energy bills. They invited our cameras to film with them and the people they help to see the almost impossible decisions they're having to make. Rebecca Barry has this special report.
You just never think that you're going to be in this position, because I never, ever, ever did.
Victoria's one of the many women who say they simply wouldn't be here if it wasn't for the support of domestic abuse services like this one on Merseyside.
This service, without a shadow of a doubt, saves lives. I wouldn't be standing here today, I don't know. I wouldn't have the fight that I've got, that I need for my kids. They've helped me with so much.
And yet it's claimed others like her are being left at risk.
So at any one time, we have 9 families resident here. We're never empty.
They've never allowed cameras in here before. A sanctuary for women and children escaping abuse. But they're now struggling to help all those that desperately need it as their funding falls short of spiralling costs.
We're in the winter months. It's dark outside. We have to have the lights on. We have to have the heating on. We've got children living here. We've got vulnerable adults living here. We can't cut off the gas and electricity supply.
Paying energy bills alone will leave them almost £20,000 in debt this winter.
So right now we've got 9 women and 17 children in the refuge currently. Now what do? Where can we get the money from to pay them bills? We can't ask the women. They come to us with nothing. Comes with the clothes that they've got on the back.
What difficult decisions are you having to make because of a lack of funding?
We've already had 90 individuals from the community that we've had to actively put on a waiting list for support. Now, how do we not know that one of them 90 individuals, that they're not going to appear on some domestic abuse homicide in the future?
You fear that women could die as a result of that?
Absolutely. We are unable to support the level of need that is out there because of a lack of investment.
A survey of domestic abuse services in England carried out exclusively for ITV News found almost all, 96%, said they're facing financial issues related to the cost of living crisis. 67% say without financial help, they'll have to stop supporting survivors, either turning them away, reducing services, or closing altogether. And almost 3/4 say their staff are going through hardship, with 1 in 5 revealing employees are using food banks. Staff here facing difficult dilemmas as their salaries are consumed by inflation.
At times I'm having to borrow money before payday. So I'm in a vicious circle to sort of get extra bits of food that's needed. It's not a novelty. It's not, you know, it's things that I need, basic things.
Do you ever consider having to leave this job to find a job that's better paid?
I have had to think about that. I have had to think about looking at what else I could do, or extra work, you know, if things, you know, carry on this way.
He'd hit me in the face.
I've got facial scars now.
At the same time, demand is increasing. In the last year here, they've seen a 60% rise in people seeking help.
What do you fear could have happened to you and your children if you hadn't had this service?
I genuinely believe it would have been fatal for me, I think. I don't think my children would have a mother now.
What do you fear could happen to other women like you if they don't have access to this sort of thing?
I fear that they'll stay stuck in that cycle and they won't have the support they need to get away.
Charities are calling on the government to give urgent financial support to domestic abuse services.
It's a sorry reflection on our society if we don't take action now to really support these services. These services need to remain operational at this point of crisis, and it is a point of crisis. You know, women and children will die and be at risk of harm unless we get this right, and we get this right now.
Back at the refuge, it feels bleak.
I've never seen a darkness that we've got now, and a lack of empathy and a lack of understanding or a real needs assessment as to what's going on. So yeah, I'm extremely angry.
The government says it's committed more than £140 million to support survivors of domestic abuse. But, as ever, it's the most vulnerable at the sharp end of this crisis. Rebecca Barry, ITV News.
And you can see more on this issue over on our website. That's itv.com/news. And the page includes details of the help and support available for anyone who's affected. Okay, let's get an update on what's making the news tonight. And the Health Secretary has blamed a combination of COVID, flu and strep A for what the government is calling unprecedented pressure on the NHS. The critics say it's down to longer-term underfunding. More than a dozen health trusts have declared critical incidents in recent days. Most rail services have now finished for the evening due to strike action by the RMT. Today is the first of five consecutive days of industrial action, the longest period of strike action on the railways for 30 years. And Pele has been laid to rest in a cemetery in his hometown of Santos this evening. Thousands lined the roadside as his coffin was transported through the streets on a fire truck. A private family funeral is being held this evening. Former Top Gear presenters James May and Matt LeBlanc have paid tribute to the rally driver Ken Block, who has died in a snowmobile accident. Block, who starred in one of the show's most controversial moments, had found fame online with his daring motoring stunts. Martha Fairley has more.
High-octane, heart-stopping stunts were the trademark of American rally driver Ken Block. Demonstrating breathtaking precision, executing seemingly impossible manoeuvres. His career began on the US rally circuit, but it was Block's daredevil driving that gained his Hoonigan brand worldwide fame. He took Top Gear's Captain Slow for a memorable spin on an airfield in California. But the show's former presenter, James May, never doubted he was in expert hands.
We're alive!
I had to camp up being scared, because with a lot of people, that would be truly terrifying, that sort of thing. But he was so good and so incredibly precise, within a minute you thought, there's absolutely nothing to worry about here. He's just not going to get anything wrong. I can sit back and enjoy the ride. The jump, I think we did that four, maybe five times to get it from every angle we wanted. You could have put a postage stamp where the front tire was going to land and it would have landed on it.
In 2016, Block was criticised for performing donuts that left tire marks next to the cenotaph while filming for Top Gear with presenter Matt LeBlanc on the streets of London.
Does Winston approve?
It doesn't look like it, does it? Sorry.
Block later said he'd kept a respectful distance, but the cenotaph sequence was never broadcast. Today, LeBlanc paid tribute on social media to a true talent and friend taken far too soon.
Ken Block had been showing off tricks on his new Skidoo just before Christmas, but it was confirmed last night he died in a snowmobile accident, his wife posting a picture of his helmet for the man who lived life in the fast lane.
Martha Fairley on the life of the rally star, Ken Block. And tributes have also been paid to Fred White, the former drummer of the American band Earth, Wind and Fire, who's died at the age of 67. His older brother and bandmate, Verdeen White, announced the death on Instagram, saying his amazing and talented sibling was now drumming with the Angels. September and Boogie Wonderland were two of the Grammy Award-winning band's biggest hits. Lenny Kravitz described Fred White as a true king of music and said he had been blessed by his influence. Here, a court has heard how the Olympic cyclist Mark Cavendish and his wife Peter were subjected to a terrifying armed robbery while at home with their children. Prosecutors said some of the alleged robbers jumped onto Cavendish, punched him and threatened to stab him with a knife. Two men are on trial accused of robbery. And Ian Woods is outside Chelmsford Crown Court for us today. Ian, what did the jury hear today?
Well, this was, according to the prosecution, no run-of-the-mill robbery by opportunistic thieves, but a well-planned and executed invasion of a well-known sportsman's home. Mark Cavendish is a former world cycling champion and regarded as the greatest sprinter in the history of the Tour de France. He was the BBC Sports Personality of the Year in 2011. Now, the robbery happened just over a year ago, and because Mark Cavendish was recovering from cycling injuries at the time, it was his wife, Peter, who is a successful model, who went downstairs to investigate noises at their semi-rural Essex home. Now, she spotted the men who were wearing balaclavas and carrying large knives coming towards her. She ran back up the stairs and into her bedroom. They followed her and punched her husband when he tried to hit a panic alarm. Now, throughout the ordeal, Peter hid their three-year-old child under a duvet so that they wouldn't see what was going on. The robbers specifically asked for, demanded, two Richard Mille watches worth a total of £700,000, as well as a safe that Mark Cavendish was unable to open. None of the stolen property has ever been recovered. Now, the court's been told that two men, Joe Jobson and George Goddard, are still wanted in connection with the attack, while another man has already pleaded guilty to robbery. The men on trial are Rosario Henry and Oladeo Okorosoba. They deny the charges, and the trial is expected to last until the end of next week.
Ian Woods in Chelmsford, thank you. Now, having lit up the leagues of Europe, Cristiano Ronaldo has officially made the move to the Middle East. The former Manchester United star was unveiled by Saudi Arabian side Al Nassr today, following his acrimonious exit from Old Trafford last month. He signed a 2.5-year contract, reportedly worth up to £160 million a year, making him the highest paid footballer in history. And the Crown Prosecution Service has announced they're investigating allegations of homophobic chanting by Nottingham Forest fans during their recent match against Chelsea. Forest had said they would also be looking into the incident. Now, it may not exactly feel like it here, but records have been shattered in an unprecedented heatwave across mainland Europe. Yesterday was the warmest winter day on record in several countries. Some experts describe the temperatures as simply incredible. Parts of France and Spain reached almost 25 degrees yesterday. That's more than 10 degrees above typical temperatures. Meanwhile, southern Poland was 19 degrees. That's well above average for this time of year. And southeast Belarus was more than 16 degrees Celsius, where it's usually in the region of minus two. Here's Sejal Karia on the unseasonal winter heat.
Winter appears to be disappearing on the lower slopes of the Swiss Alps. Hillsides blanketed in the green of grass rather than the white of snow. And when the white stuff stops falling, it's time to make your own. These skiers speeding down on snow made by machines, which are topping up all the slopes and keeping the season going. But in parts of France, the snow being a no-show meant some resorts being forced to close. As remarkable warm January weather is breaking records across Europe, from Berlin to here in Bucharest, where people were plunging into outdoor pools rather than the usual trudging through feet of snow. One of the most striking temperatures for January was here in Warsaw, the Polish capital seeing almost 19 Celsius on New Year's Day, 5 degrees higher than the previous record.
But in the context of climate change, where we're talking about 1.5, 2 degrees of warming over centuries, then the idea that the record goes up by 5 degrees, that's an awful lot. And it's climate change that's making these occurrences happen more often.
For France, a year marked by heat waves ended with spring-like temperatures in midwinter. And scientists warn this warming is likely to become more common. Sejal Karia, ITV News.
We will be staying with the weather in just a moment on the ITV Evening News.
Yes, a mild start to January and plenty of unsettled weather ahead, plus a meteor shower tonight to keep your eyes peeled for.
And has polish lost its shine? Why, so few of us are now making our shoes sparkle. Do join me for that and more in just a few minutes. See you then.
This is a 30-second ad. That's not long, but it's long enough to do something that could save you money on your energy bills. In 30 seconds, you can turn a boiler flow temperature down here, or switch these off there, change this, reduce that, or close all of these at night. Each one you do will be 30 seconds well spent. They all add up and could save you money. Visit gov.uk/saveenergy for more energy saving ideas.
Beryl's bungalow used to play tricks on her. She found the rooms were never where they should be. It wasn't until we stuck pictures to every door that Beryl felt home again. Just a carer. No such thing. Become a Home Instead care professional today.
And welcome back. Now, if you are lucky enough to get clear skies tonight, you could be in for a bit of a treat because one of the strongest and most spectacular meteor showers of the year is going to be visible. Well, Joe Blythe's in Salford for us tonight. I mean, this will be quite a sight, won't it, Joe?
Well, I hope so, Mary, but it does depend on quite a few factors weather-wise. The annual quadranted meteor shower does peak tonight in the skies above the UK. Up to 110 meteors could be visible per hour through the early hours of tomorrow morning. Now, meteors are bits of space debris that enter the Earth's atmosphere. They vaporise, creating a white streak of light that looks like a shooting star. But the weather is an important factor. It's been raining here all day in Manchester. It's windy and it's cloudy. But there are parts of the country where you could be in with a chance of seeing them tonight under clear skies, perhaps later on. Of course, there are dark sky areas across the country. The Brecon Beacons, Snowdonia, parts of Northumberland and Exmoor National Park. But for many places, it is going to be quite cloudy. And it's just not the best conditions at all for seeing this beautiful sight. Another condition that you'd need is little light pollution. And in towns and cities, that's a real factor. Also, the moon is nearly full, and that's going to interfere with stargazing, certainly over the hours. Now, it's quite mild here tonight, and the mild theme continues going forward, but there's some very unsettled weather on the cards. Let's take a look at the national forecast.
It's a cold and wet outlook, with some heavy downpours throughout the day. Heinz Big Soup sponsors ITV National Weather.
Unsettled weather through the rest of this week will really feature spells of rain at times, some of it rather heavy, accompanied by gusty winds, gale force along our coastline in one or two spots tonight and tomorrow. It is quite mild until the weekend when temperatures just drop off a little bit and it'll turn just a little bit chillier. In a bit more detail then, low pressure very much in charge of things as we go through the next few days and nights, and systems will be moving in from the Atlantic accompanied by those strong winds, putting down quite a lot of rain, particularly for higher ground in Scotland and Wales through tonight and tomorrow. So warnings in place to cater to that. For the rest of us, as we go through into this evening, it will be quite damp and cloudy for a time. We'll begin to see skies clearing for some of us, but further rainfall is expected in the west. And as sky is clear, winds will increase in strength. Gales expected along many coastlines into tomorrow morning. Now on to tomorrow, a better day in prospect. It is going to be brighter, even here in Manchester. There should be a bit of sunshine to look forward to, but quite showery from the word go. And during the afternoon, some of these showers will intensify across the middle part of the country and the Midlands, certainly. Into the afternoon, it's mild, most places in double figures, and perhaps in the southeast, it could get up to around 14 Celsius. Quite windy, but that wind beginning to ease later on in the day. Thursday, not a bad day, but later on, rain will move in across most places. At the moment, a bit of respite on Friday. High pressure should give us a dry day.
Heinz Big Soup sponsors ITV National Weather.
Well, if you're brave enough to look for those beautiful meteors tonight, I hope you spot them. Do let us know. I don't think there's much chance here in Salford, but you never know. Take care. Back to you, Mary.
All right. Jo Blythe in Salford, thank you, and fingers crossed, you never know. And finally tonight, when was the last time you polished your shoes? Maybe you don't even own any traditional leather ones and only wear trainers, even for work. Now, one of the leading shoe polish companies says it's going to be pulling out of the UK market because of dwindling sales. It blamed a rise in working from home and the growing trend for casual clothes. Martin Stew reports on why the shine has rubbed off.
Good day for the shoe shine boy.
Since 1906, one brand of shoe polish has cleaned up around the world.
Before I shined, I had to polish.
For decades, the British military have used kiwi. In fact, it's still the preferred polish of the household cavalry. Now, in this country at least, the brand is in danger of extinction. They say they're stopping distribution after sales hit the buffers. The move has been described as a sign of the times, as smart has turned casual.
You're literally not going to see or talk to anyone the entire day.
As more of us work from home.
A few generations ago, men had a work wardrobe and a leisure wardrobe, and those two very, very rarely met. And now, due to the nature of how we work and where we work, those two wardrobes are very interchangeable.
When even red carpets are dominated by multicoloured loafers and trainers, what hope does polish have in our disposable society?
Hi, brother. That's sabotage. Look what you've done. You can say goodbye to that pair.
George's valet company specialise in preserving premium items.
You can have a disposable society, or a society that perhaps spends a little bit more on their garments and perhaps just looks after them a little bit better, and therefore they'll last a bit longer.
For now, polish may have lost its luster.
But if you really want to feel fine,
but fashion is fickle.
Give your shoes a shine.
Martin Stew, ITV News.
And that's all from us for now. Tom's here with news at 10, but from me and the evening news team, bye-bye.